hear nothing whatsoever changes there. So in collapse theory, you know, it's kind of two books. Something happened in both, even in two particles, something happened. In many worlds, it doesn't happen. You do something here, you make a measurement here, nothing changes there whatsoever. Nothing on the level of all worlds together. If for us, living in a particular world, we have this kind of well-known locality, worlds are non-local, so in a sense, also in the many worlds, there is this entanglement non-locality. What's not present, which I think is not good for physical theory, real physical theories explain all physics, that you do something here and something there changes. This doesn't exist in many worlds, therefore it can be made relativistically covariant, you don't need preferred frame to make it nice. So this is why I think that many worlds does can be a candidate for the complete description of physics, and as interpretation and not.
I actually disagree with your claim that maybe we don't want to go into details now. So I can maybe explain on another. It's my own lecture.
Okay. I did that here too.
Okay. Now, the path of a quantum particle. I will make a list of different interpretations what they think about this, but a kind of general goal said don't talk about it. And the people, person who kind of a serious person to talk about was Wheeler, and here I agree that I disagree with Wheeler. And I think I do have kind of a way to talk about this, and this is one of the important fruits of two-state vector formalism, which allows me to talk about the past of a quantum particle. So, consider Mach Zehnder interferometer without a second beam splitter. So this is kind of Wheeler type situation. It will add a beam splitter here. It will be Mach Zehnder interferometer, but we take it out. It seems a pretty very simple optical device, and but I want to ask where was the particle. Because when we send a particle, we don't see it. Usually we don't see it on flight. So we send a single photon and good detection here. And we ask where it was. So let's see. Or don't ask. In a sense, it's very consistent. Picture, no paradoxes, no problem, but I think at least I will not count on my interaction-free measurement if I will not ask. So I think sometimes asking, don't ask, is not very fruitful for pushing physics forward. What I understand is a textbook, and in fact I think it's somewhat sympathetic to this picture. So we have a wave which evolves until collapse. So this is a wave. So the photon was all over because the wave, this is where the photon was. And then it was collapse, and so it was everywhere. This is kind of a textbook picture. Bohm, I think we have seen this picture. I think the Bell was the first to show this. That kind of strange. It goes here, there's nothing here, but it's but this is it. This is where the Bohmian particle was.
Why doesn't go the average? Why go down?
Because you can use no crossing theorem, you can use other things, you can use some nice picture, because there are the two wave packets. One wave packet comes from here, and one wave packet comes from here. Now they meet, and now they overlap. And the Bohmian theory tells that the particle, Bohmian particle, goes with the current. So if it's here, it will continue to go, then it's here. But when it's come here, then it feels this new wave, so it feels two waves. So you have J from here, and you have j from here. So it would start moving like this. So in this direction, it will not move because this is the velocity. Now, if you see, it's not moving this direction, and now they continue. This goes here, this goes here. You see that this one has to catch it because this one has whole size, and this has only this small size. So during the overlap in this direction, they don't, the point don't move. But in some moment, this will be kind of, it's not, this is here and this is here. So this is disappear and this will catch it and it will go like this.
You
so you can mechanically.
That's the symmetry.
What?
Plane. You could also say there's a symmetry plane like this.
There is a symmetry, there's no crossing, whatever, but I like to see, you can see, you can easily see there is a simple row that x dot or x vector dot is j over row. And then the fact if it's equal weight, you just understand that it must happen. What may be a little more interesting, that if you put all kinds of detectors, which are not Bohmian detectors, for example, if here spins, which flip every time the particle go near it, that and if you look on this spins, after it crosses this point, you will see that the spins were flipped only here, and not here. But the Bohmian still will say, no, the particle go here, but the flips were here. Kind of non, because Bohmian mechanics is non-local, and some people say, great, this is how it's interesting. But some other people will say, if we have some kind of detectors of position, so if it's fast detector, it gives you a correct Bohmian position, but if your detector is slow, then they will show that the particle was here, even if the Bohmian was here. So the Bohmian, when they go to the whatever, that they order position detectors, they have to ask how fast they are. If not Bohmians, don't have to do this. So some physicists say that we don't want to mess with it, so let's not be Bohmian, because we have less problem. All position measurements, which kind of, we don't have to worry if they're fast enough or not. Okay. Wheeler. So Wheeler, although he was related to Bohr and kind of whatever, but he took courage in some moment and said that until it was detected, we really don't know what to say, where is the particle, but after it was detected. And if there is only one possibility to go, here there are two options. From here you cannot come here, from here you can. If this is the one option, now I know the photon was here. Now, in maybe not so loud language, he said that if it will be a beam splitter, then in some sense it was in two places. And then he said, okay, it kind of affects the past. Because if we take out the things, it was in two places, now it's in one place. This is how all this work is famous, delayed choice. But for me, there is no delay. I just look without this. And clearly, he will say that in this kind of situation, this is the projector. Okay, this is kind of different formalism, but I believe that what's important is operation of meaning. This is, of course, at the end of the day, I want ontology and what is there. But if what is there not connected to our experiment and what we see, I think it's not of much interest. So, let's think about operational meaning. Well, what kind of operational meaning might be of? So, I think one idea, we have this start here, and today, I think Rampin is the first, I don't know, he's the only, he knows how to measure photons in flight. So if there is a photon, you can test if it was there and let it go. So the question, if you put kind of non-degulation measurement, let's say here, will it find the photon or not? And the answer, it will not. Only measurement here will find the photon. So according to this definition, the photon was in every place in which we will find it if we will use this non-demolition detector. Then we'll find this. This is the path.
So non-demolition means you don't absorb the photon.
You don't absorb the photon. So if the photon was here, you get a clip, it is here, and it continues to go. Now, of course, if it's in superposition, this is kind of, you can make collapse or whatever, you may find it, might not find it. Here you find it with certainty. It cannot be that you will not find it, because if you will not find it, you will never get a clip. You got a clip, so you must find it. Any place, in any of these places, if you look, and if your detector is efficient, you must find it. Now, another kind of nature of saying that in a place the photon is present, you can affect it, you can do something to it. So if your detector here is not just say yes, no, but can tell where exactly it comes. And you know that in original situation there is a particular line where it's supposed to come. So you can know if it's will arrive in a slightly different place. So you ask, if I put kind of piece of glass will kind of, because of, will break it and move it. But if the photon come here, it will go a little up, then it will not come here anyway. But here, this piece of glass will move it slightly up. So you look on in this situation, everything which comes to this detector, and you see, when they go up, when you put some distortion. And you see, you put the distortion here, nothing happened, but you put distortion here, go up. So you say, okay, it must be here. Maybe another thing which kind of against the spirit of two-state vector formalism. Two-state vector formalism says pre-selection, post-selection. Usually I don't ask the question, what is the probability of post-selection? But maybe that's a good question. I think if the photon was not here, it was not in a place the photon was not, I can put block, I can put some absorber, nothing will happen to its intensity here. And so I put something here, nothing happened to intensity, but I put something here, the intensity goes down. So I think every place where I can influence the intensity, it's where it was photon was. And so we'll get this trajectory. Now, so you see, all operational meaning gives the same picture. There is one more operational meaning which I like most. I believe that there is locality in nature, all interaction are local, and also I believe that there is no such thing as zero interaction. So I think this thing, if move here, clearly, now we understand, it kind of move molecule here. When the photons from there go up to here, really we see them here, but on the way, I think they also influence. So even a single photon, I think that it's localized, when it's everywhere it goes, it changes the environment here. So maybe neutrinos here, whatever. Changes not the orthogonal state that we'll be able to know, but changes the quantum state slightly. I believe it must be a local change of a quantum state. And I can, in principle, in this experiment, the change is very small. But if I will repeat many, 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 many times, pre-selection, post-selection, I can see where the air was heated, here or here. And I will see it was heated here, it was not heated here. So this is weak trace. I believe that the particle was where it left a weak trace. This is a kind of, really, the message which I would like to give here. This will be my main definition. But till now, it's one of many. Okay. So, looking on this kind of story, we have to say that okay, this is inconsistent but not useful. This is kind of inconsistent. Maybe we can understand it. We have to go to some entanglement to understand the standard picture. The Bohmian is not useful for this kind of thing. It doesn't tell us where the trace. And Wheeler looks very nice.
So you say that everything sequences that kind of shifts the final detection position.
Yeah.
So how do you tell the difference between the two different paths?
Because if I put this one.
Oh, yeah.
I put something here, nothing changed.
Okay.
If I put something here, changed.
Oh, okay.
So then I think every place where I can disturb my final photon in some way, I know that the photon was there. How you can, because I believe on locality, I cannot disturb my photon non-locally. So this piece, if it's not where the photon was, will not disturb the photon.
Oh, okay, so that does not apply to the bottom thing.
I consider only where was the pre- and post-selected particle. So, it's essentially this Wheeler was discussing exactly this, because he was discussing photons which were found later. So, we are talking about pre- and post-selected particles. To state vector formalism, talk about pre- and post-selected system. This is where it's useful. So, I think the whole story is interesting, this is all kind of natural and another interpretation and nothing paradoxical. But it turned out that we can consider another example which looks very paradoxical, which I came out kind of was kind of an accident. Essentially, in interaction-free measurement, what we found, we can find that there is a bone without photon being near it. And I was pretty sure that I cannot find that the place is empty without being there. It's kind of logic, when there is a bomb, there is a world with explosion, so it all things together, I was there, and then so I can make it not paradoxical. But if the place is empty, there is no world with explosion. So I thought it's impossible. So I thought we cannot make interaction-free measurement and saying nothing. Now, interaction-free measurement was taken by Josa, and he put this bomb kind of a computer which calculates function of 0 and 1 and said it's a counterfactual computation. Instead of exploding a bomb, he made some calculation. If photon goes through, it's zero. If photon absorbed, it's one. And so, one is like explosion. So he found the outcome one without photon running, because I know how to find a bomb without exploding it. So it's the same story. We have this bomb, we have the computer, which the photon was not absorbed, so the computer didn't run, but we know the outcome of the computation. And I think Joseph himself also said that it's kind of limited computer, because it knows how to counterfactually, without running, to find one, but it doesn't know how to counterfactually to measure zero, to find if the function is zero, then the computer is running. And he thought it's impossible to do the computation for 0 and 1. And then Kwiat found and published, I think, in Nature, a paper, counterfactual communication of both variables, both 0 and 1. It used kind of Zeno effect, it was kind of a complicated system. And then I thought that he caught me twice. He already caught me kind of in this interaction for measurement. In the end, it was written that it's apparently the maximum efficiency is 50%. And Kwiat with Zeilingen and some other places, when they made the experiment, they also proposed a method how to make it efficient up to any efficiency, as close to 100% as possible. And so it was one of my mistakes we made. And I thought that maybe here there is another mistake. So it took me 2 months to work on this paper of Kwiat, and then I realized that essentially you can make it simple like this, and it's simple like this. Essentially, it's a three-box kind of paradox. And although there is a very good reason, let me tell that he is right, but I don't think that he is right. So, sorry about this interlude. You see, okay. The point is that in this interferometer, what is this? It's nested interferometer. We have one interferometer which is tuned that everything which goes here goes out. And it's, so then essentially it's very much like, if you look on a big interferometer, it's very much like Wheeler case. Because there is a big interferometer like this. Something, if it go here, it will continue here, there is a big interferometer. But I kind of didn't let this pass to go. Instead of removing this, I put here a tuned interferometer. But it seems very much the same. So I think when I get click here, the only way is to come from here. It seems very much similar. So, however, in this situation, and then start to ask my operational meaning, the picture will be different. My operational meaning, where it could be found in the local non-devolution measure. I found that the picture is not Wheeler's picture. Wheeler's picture would be like this. Because this is the only way for a photon to come. It is enter here and disappears. But if you look on operational meaning, if I try to find the photon, how I try the photon? Yes. Here. I put a non-devolution detector here. It's like testing Wheeler. It must click, because if it does not click, I will not get click here. I put it here. It cannot click, because if it would click, I will never get it here. So essentially, it cannot be here. But, and again, it's true here. I cannot find it here, so this is also true. But if I put my non-devolution detector here, non-devolution detector make photon go here, pass through. But it destroys interference. I know which pass. If I know which pass, now there is a leakage here. So now I can get click here. So my non-devolution detector can find photon here, moreover with particular phases. I can arrange that have to find here. It's really three box situation. This and one of them, it will find with certainty. If I put it here, it will find the photon. Photon with certainty, exactly as here. So I cannot say that Wheeler is right. It's here because it's, the photon will be found here with certainty, but it also will be found with certainty here. So now I can ask other thing, where a local field could change the particle. If I put something here, it will shift the picture. If I put here, it will not shift the picture. Here it also will not shift the picture, because the shifted will be something which will not come to the detector. But if I'll but if I put something here, I destroy slightly the interference. There is some leakage. The leakage is small, but because of the interference with this, it will be exactly the same effect as I put it here. So from this point of view, it's the same picture. Air condition doesn't work because absorber. The same story about absorber. Of course, my intensity will go down. My intensity will not be influenced. The intensity will not be influenced. My intensity here will be influenced, because when I put absorber here, I will change the interference. In fact, sometimes I will it will be influenced maybe in a strange way. I can get a bigger signal. But clearly, if I change something about my photons here, so I think, okay, the photon was here because they influenced. I cannot say that the photon was not here, because I put something here and my photon behaved differently. Where is left a big trace? I think that it was this story about Quirt, I understood it. I wrote a paper, sent it, I think, it was in field was nature, so I sent it to nature, it worked. I think in the end, so it was very difficult for me to publish kind of attack on field. It took some time. And so I thought that maybe people would be persuaded if I would make an experiment. Theoretical paper in the end, the theoretical paper was accepted only in PRA, but I delayed it because I wanted, didn't want to endanger the experiment. So the experiment, I think, came before the theoretical paper, so the theoretical paper was accepted, I think, 6 months before PRA. At least I found the limit. After 6 months, they said, either you will publish it or forget about it. So we made this experiment in Tel Aviv, essentially my first experimental effort. I think I designed the experiment and went down in the laboratory of Shimshon Barad and worked. I was kind of lucky because in the experiment I wanted to ask photons where they have been. The picture was a little long because there are some small mirrors, and I wanted to know if they here, many places. So one of the idea was to put some small disturbance, kind of small thing in one place, and to see how it disturbs. In the end, I have only one special detector. I could make it special, but I can. There is a left, right. I didn't have too many places, and I wanted to test as many places as possible. So I came up with the idea of wiggling mirrors with different frequencies. And this idea also improved my noise to signal to noise ratio because I looked on Fourier transform by a factor of, I think, like 30. And then it was relatively not so difficult to perform the experiment, so it was succeeded. And the experiment, I even get this picture for PRL, which my relation with Callisto, it's very strange. There are many kind of attacks in this paper, and there are some people repeated it in some other So, this experiment was done with a continuous light, with wiggling mirrors. Another experiment, they put kind of devices which introduce small addition of some frequencies. And then here they look on these frequencies. One of my next students took part in it. And here they kind of agree with my conclusions. There was another experiment with neutrons. When I looked on the result, on more the simulation, because the result was not so clear about the simulation, of what is supposed to get, I think, were pretty clear. I saw that it's exactly what my conclusions are. And my conclusion as the photon was here and was here. More precisely, the weak trace was here. Because my definition of the photon was where was a weak trace. And I believe that they did found exactly this, but they, every place in the paper they say that my interpretation is wrong, they didn't find it. So if you read it together with this, then this is another experiment telling about this weak trace. And so the weak trace says that the photon was here and here. So if we come back to this story and look on this nested interferometer, so again, Bohr said don't talk about it. And this is what von Neumann says, everywhere. But this is not what we got. We didn't got any kind of weak trace here. This is what will say Bohmian. In this case, the Bohmian may be kind of really, in this configuration, Bohmian is not strange. In some other configuration, you can, because here there's no kind of anomalies. Here's a Bohm agree with Wheeler. Wheeler will say this. But none of them give the operational picture. If you think operationally, the place where you can find the photon, maybe not with certainty, here with certainty, but where it could be found in the local non-Hermitian network, I don't think certainty. So I get my picture. This where local field could change the particle state. In a sense, this is what's measured in experiments. Unfortunately, no experiment really measured the trace which was left on environment. This is a very difficult experiment. Because a trace was left on the particle itself on some other degree. So more or less it was this kind of experiment. And in observer, also it will calculate what's happened to the observer, it should be like this. And the weak traits I claim in this experiment of the more honestly, the experiment which has been performed is this one, which I interpreted it like this. So, let me repeat to state vector formalism. Because you see, this is operational meaning. This is kind of a, which gives some picture, which also tested an experiment. And this is different formalism. And none of them give this picture. So, how we can formally can understand this picture? How we calculate it? This is kind of calculation. What is the way to understand it? This is why I think the two-state vector formalism is helpful, because this is exactly works for cases when system are pre and post-selected. Now we have one state, we have this other state, we have these two states which are an equal footing, we have to take both of them into account. We can use this weak value, that they are really meaning, so we can calculate using this weak value. And the weak value of projection operator will give us exactly this picture. But even without kind of this weak value, there is a very simple way to understand how the two-state vector formalism gives this picture. We have this is a picture I draw. This is a forward evolving wave function. Now I got a click here. So there is a backward evolving wave function starting from here. It must be like this, because you remember, this is a tuned Mach-Zehnder interferometer. Everything which comes here go out here. So if it will come from here, it must go here, and everything is time reversal. So if I come from here, I cannot go here, it must go here. So this is a backward evolving wave function of photons detected here. Now we look together, and we see, here and here, there is overlap. So the particle was, pre and post selected particle, the past is where was the overlap of a forward and backward evolving wave function. It of course goes together with my kind of physical definition. It's where to leave a weak trace. To leave a weak trace, we need a weak value of projection non-zero. If one of them is, if there is no one of the wave function, forward or backward, it's automatically everything local will be zero there. So here the weak value is zero, here is zero, but where is a two-way function, it will not be zero.
And so has that been proved in general, that for any arrangement, more complicated method in parameters, this overlap region is exactly the same as the region where it will leave a weak trace?
Yes. One has to mention that I have to arrange specially, I have to make this destructive interference, so then I get this kind of paradoxical situation. If I arbitrarily arrange this and not make destructive interference, then overlap will be everywhere. But this property, this is general. Whatever there is overlap, so you can say formal definition, the particle goes where this overlap of the forward and backward wave function, which is equivalent to the operational meaning where it leaves a weak trace, local weak trace. So it's overlap of the forward and backward evolving wave function, where it leaves a weak trace. Okay, now a little more kind of persuasion about this. Again, all interactions are local, all particles have non-zero local interaction. And I believe that if the particle go here, there is something, some trace left here. If I look here, I want to say that the particle was here. It means that there is some local, if there is kind of a molecule here, this molecule will be slightly shifted. It's wave function will be tiny shifted. If there is something with spin or polarization, this polarization will be tiny rotated. So all this small rotation in a place here, there will be nothing, and here will be changed, maybe very, very small. And this is kind of a simple case. I really know that the particle was here. I started here, I started here, it was only here. It's one of the most interesting cases when it's in superposition, and this is what I will discuss. And formally, I can say this is the environment, local environment here. If the particle is there, it gets an orthogonal part. Maybe very, very small. But now I will always look on this, what will be the trace when I really send a particle here. When there is a trace of this size, then the particle is there. There is no trace, it's remained as if the particle was not there. Now, if some people say all this my discussion about physical local interaction, not maybe not in place, in all this optical experiment, there is a one thing which everyone should agree. There is this in mirrors. These mirrors get photons. Photons got kicked. You don't have interferometer without mirrors. And when it got hit, it changed momentum. So the momentum of this mirror changes. Now, I don't know how many people solved the exercise. It doesn't mean that the mirror knows that the photon was here. How the interferometer works? Because mirror have to be well localized. So when it's well localized, due to uncertainty principle, the momentum should be very uncertain. So the state momentum state of a mirror, it has very large uncertainty, but not infinite. It's not a black hole. So it has very large uncertainty, and so it starts from this state to this state. It's slightly different state. There is some epsilon there. And in fact, this epsilon can be for any operator, momentum, whatever, there is this, you can use this formula, proportional to epsilon. And this, all these things are, there is this epsilon, I think, this is my criteria. Every time that I have a particle, my environment gets some orthogonal component, it has epsilon. And this epsilon is linear in all changes of variables. So everything, all variables will be changed essentially proportional to this epsilon. Okay, so to be in A, it's to leave this local trace of this small size, not to be to leave zero trace. So, but my question is now, what I want to say is that the photon that it's not only that I can talk about the past, and to be or not to be, or I can talk much more. Quantum particle has more types of being. Classical, to be or not to be. Quantum particle can be in different type of ways. And I consider a particle inside the interferometer, and I ask, what kind of being is here? Because it's not, in a sense, you can translate it to the famous thing about two slits, it's the same story. In which way it's in particular slit, but Max Zender is much cleaner and much easier to discuss. So what kind of being of the particle is here? So I send it, it's kind of split, it goes here, and again, I don't talk about every particle, I talk about this particle. The one which started here end up here. There is another one which end up here. But my question is about pre and post selected one. So I say to be it's to leave a local trace in A. So the question, what kind of trace it is? So let's start with kind of I want to compare it to a single particle trace when there is no question that it's a single particle trace. So I have my device, but I put my source here, detector here, I have no doubts. My particle was here, I send it here, I get some trace. The trace is really my mirror was shifted by delta p, so it's changes its quantum state, it got some orthogonal component, particular value. So this means the particle was in A. Now, another case, I don't send anything. I didn't switch on my single photon detector, I didn't send any photon. So now I have to say that there's no photon. But I want to ask to know it's about operation, and I want to look and to know if there is or there is not. So what I claim here, nothing changed to the environment, and so it was not an A. It is not that, like, somebody have two devices, and once the photon was sent, another was not sent, and I was not outside of the room. I cannot enter and to tell which one is which. Because this change is tiny, there is only epsilon. But if I believe in quantum mechanics, there is nothing except quantum mechanics. So I believe that if I will repeat the same experiment many, many times, it's the same story. It's the same pre-post selection. So I have a large ensemble, one like this and one like this. I didn't see the detector that they were taken out. I could, on the large ensemble, to see this change. So I can, there is a difference. It's a local weak trace. It's there. It's I might not find it on single system, but I can test that it's present. So the interesting case is this one. I start, go here, and then I look, and then I get finally click here. So the question, what kind of trace I will get? It turned out that there is a very simple modification of the single particle trace for this kind of situation. What I have to do is a pre-post selected particle. So what I have to, it has a weak value of projection operator here. This weak value, you remember, it might be complex, might be strange, big, small, whatever. All what's happening is that I have to multiply this amplitude by the weak value. This is the only change which happens. So, the question, how I will see it. What will happen that my change in momentum will be multiplied by the real part of this weak value. But even if the real part of this value is zero, it doesn't mean that the particle is not there, because I can, that the change might be not in the real part, because if I have a weak value imaginary, I still have change. It will not change the momentum, it will change the position. My mirror will be shifted. So, whenever I have this non-zero weak value of projection, I will have some measurable changes in my environment. Now my environment is this mirror. So, I want to say that instead of kind of being yes and no, there is a being with this complex number. Being an A, it's a weak value of projection operator. It works here because weak value here is 1 and weak here value here is 0. So to be an A, to have to be presence 1, presence 0, but this presence can be any complex number. So, what type of presence given by this weak value of projection operator? And this weak value tell us how every interaction here is modified. I consider just kind of keep of a mirror. But together with Jan, we made an experiment with three different couplings. And we saw that it's universal. So, if there is a one particle, we have one change. We have a weak value, the change will be modified. The same orthogonal component, somewhat interesting. The orthogonal component doesn't change. The only thing we change is the amplitude of this orthogonal component. The strength of the change. But again, in the moment, it's make imaginary, this is important. It will look different. It will physically different. So it tells us how effects of all weak are short enough. When it's short, everything, it doesn't have to be weak. When it's short enough, it's automatically weak. And this strong interaction, but very, very tiny weak value of infinitesimal time, it likes an eigen value, like a C number. So this is weak value of projection, tell us how all weak coupling are modified. So not to be in A, this thing doesn't work. Like you open the door, it's even worse. So not to be in A, no change. Nothing, variables, moment, conjugate, do not change.
Now it's stronger. Now it's
yeah. You feel it?
Yes.
Okay.
Feel it?
Okay, at least if the audience feel it, it's...
No.
Okay, so to be... if it's well localized, this is kind of meaning when the particle is. Usually you cannot say quantum particle there or not there, but if it's well localized, it behaves like classical. So the case when we have well localized moving, so this is presence 1. Presence 1 corresponds to this formula. This kind of change is quite in if some kind of pointer variable which tests this. But if we have this presence print post selected which is modified, then we can get this kind of the pointer will go bigger or smaller depending on the real part of this weak value. And it's also the conjugate to the pointer variable will go proportional to the imaginary part of this figure. We made an experiment in Munich and in which we really tested the universality of these changes. So I want to claim that here, this projection operator tell us about every change. So all changes will be modified according to this number. Now, unfortunately, the mirror or anything else external was not our measuring device. The measuring device was half the degrees of freedom of our particle because otherwise it's very difficult to make weak measurement. Weak measurement we need pre and post selection. We have to look only on particles coming here. So if you look on one to mirror, we have to kind of switch on and off every time there is a counting here. We had many photons, no way to do this. But here, all photons which come in here, they are post selected properly. So if we make some interaction which recording the result of interaction on the photon itself, we can learn it here. So here's this kind of analyzer. Everything which came here was analyzed in kind of different properties. And so this is kind of conceptual thing for Miro, but really everything was sitting on our particle itself. This is our kind of state of the particle, where it is, A and B, and we kind of, it's kind of an equal beam splitter. The final, so it's come here, and then this is the environment, and here there is some coupling, and so the environment got orthogonal components, and here we have the post-selection was just on 50-50 beam splitter, so on A plus B, and here was analyzer, and for this it was particular change. If we would look on this one, there will be another change, because these are different post-selection, so they had different presence here. The photons which came here were one presence, this had was another presence, there was another type of weak value in this place. We didn't measure this other one. Now, looking at the parameter of our thing, the weak value can depend on the parameter how we distribute it between this alpha, and this tangens alpha, and we had this the phase. In the experiment, what we did, we scanned the phase, so we could see many weak values. So we can not just one weak value, but a line of weak values. Essentially, all this line, that particular value of alpha, and it's kind of important how with the interferometer was what was essentially the visibility of the interferometer. this change, but we get this different change. And there were three types of thing. We look on change in position in one dimension, momentum in orthogonal dimension, and change in polarization. So this will be, it's the same particle, it's, but it had three different effects. In shift, kick, and tiny polarization rotation. So then the shift have to be multiplied by real part. The momentum, because of the change, also to be changed by the momentum. However, the conjugate to the shift has to be also modified every time in the moment we have imaginary part. And also this one, you could due to imaginary part, the shift in position and y has to be modified. Polarization. It has to be rotated more by this number, but some conjugate to rotation in one direction polarization in some other direction. So it had to be rotated also in some other direction. So all this was done in Mach-Zehnder interferometer. We had this mirror which was moved, and this corresponds to the shift x, kind of moved up, and it was tilted to go out of the plane. So this was kind of momentum. The moment we make tiny rotation of this mirror, we kind of kicked the photons outside, and here it was small polarization rotation. And so this is our state, it's come here, there was a coupling here, there was a post selection here, and again, we made a scan, here was this scanning, in fact, it's not, it was kind of trombone for difference in position, which gave us different scanning. So this is kind of all the radius we had to see. And now to analyze the position, we had two spatial detectors. One close, one far away. This allows us to see what is the shift and what is the kick, because the change in momentum we'll see far away. Taking into account all this, we could calculate what really was the shift and the kick. Both, it was two-dimensional, so it gave us both x and y. And this is our data. We tried to make shift only in x, so in p we tried to not to make any change. So there is one reference. So this is zero. And this one was shifted relative to this by this shift. So this is shift. This we see if we block if we block this, we see only reference. If we block reference, we see only this. When we get two of them together, so now my photon is really kind of pre and post selected and being in a superposition and then being found here with interference. And then, this is what, in fact, the kind of black points, this is a experimental data, and the purple is the theory, which essentially is a weak value, this weak value. Now we did testing this equation, that there are weak, that the shift is multiplied by the weak value. The purple is weak value.
It's hard for us to see. Are the black points exactly on the curve?
You see here, not exactly.
Oh, okay.
But here they really kind of fit very well. So maybe partly because we didn't succeed exactly to make, this was supposed to be zero according to what we wanted, but it wasn't. So this is kind of, in Munich, until it's not there, the paper don't go out. Given that they have to wait many years and being the last in Bell inequality experiment. This is how the laboratory works. So this took pretty long time. Now, and this is for Y. Here the discrepancy is slightly more, but as you see, pretty good. This is when we look on this, when we look on Y direction, both position and momentum change. And there was some beam splitter which took out, and then there was another beam splitter, so it was tomography of polarization. So we could see how the polarization was rotated. And here also got this, where I think, pretty much very good correspondence, I would sell this with results. Experimental foundations, which I usually see, don't have this kind of correspondence between theory and prediction. And summary. Brilliant was selected particle where it was, where it left a local trace. This is kind of operational definition. The former lesson tell us it's in the overlap of the forward and backward Kermit wave function, which I think it's very, it's useful. Again, it's not that I cannot, not that I need this two-state vector formalism to replace quantum mechanics, the same quantum mechanics. But to understand it, otherwise it's kind of interference effect, all kind of, I have to look at entanglement with my measuring device. And from my experience, I gave many talks about this, asking photons where they had been. And no one, when I give the talk, I show this interferometer, I show which mirror, whatever, and I ask audience which signal I should get. And I told them it should be just C, because otherwise there would be no talk. No one told me that I will get C, A, and B, and no E, and no F. So, but using this two-state vector formalism, it's immediate. So, what type of presence it had? The presence is really this complex number tell me the places to be or not to be. To be, it's being, you can be 7 plus 3i. It means that you will be 7 times stronger, but also you get some conjugate kick 3 times stronger. It's also going to be 0.5. This means that it will be as if there is a half particle. In three-box experiment, we have this weak value 1, 1, and minus 1. That I said, that the pressure in the first will be as if no particles are there, but in the last one it will be negative pressure, exactly of the same size, because the weak effect will be multiplied by this weak value, it was minus 100. So a weak interaction in A are modified in the same way, and so this is universal. Whatever we can recoupling, local recoupling is there, everything will be changed exactly in the same way. So this kind of orthogonal, you can take all of them together, but then you look on different variables, and you'll see that all shifts, all variables will be shifted according to this this number. The coupling, if it's coupled to A, then A will, this coupling will be multiplied to whatever, any kind of variable will be multiplied by the real part, and the conjugate will be multiplied by imaginary. So, I started, I think, 1 hour ago.
Yeah, so yeah. Maybe, yeah, since we're behind schedule.
Yeah, yeah, so maybe in a non-counterfactual communication, it's just a kind of, just maybe just to say what it is without giving a talk. Quantum communication is communication with kind of quantum carriers. Counterfactual communication, when we have a channel, and maybe we do send some particles in this channel, but then we sometimes we discard as no communication. And the only communication happens only when it's not discarded. And when it's not discarded, no particles are present in the channel. This is what's counterfactual communication, but some other time. And that's okay.
Let's go back in time.
I have a paper of time translation machine. In principle, you can, but it's very inefficient, and in most cases, you are dead when you travel. Not recommended. So, any kind of question?
So when you talk about the face, can I just say that basically the mirror is some sort of weak measurement that you expect that information to know what?
usually kind of when I do, when I demonstrate this, I kind of perform what's called weak measure. But what I kind of my philosophy is I go to laboratory and I run my interferometer. And I know that if it's post-selected here, that the here the air was heated and here it was not heated. And sometimes it might be in classical physics tells me something different. And it cannot go there at all, so it cannot be heated there. It's kind of very strange. But in my theory tells me, give me easy way to calculate where it was, where will be this weak trace. If I want to measure it, I can go and make a big effort into measuring. Usually I will call it weak measure. But the idea is that you just make an experiment and then after it I enter and try to find where the trace is for. And I say the trace is for